Thank you very much, and I am very pleased, you know, to make this presentation about cloud and startups and why startups like cloud. So I have been working for IBM for nearly 19 years. 19, yes. It's a lot. And well, I have been working in cloud, let's say, from the beginning of IBM, so nearly 10 years, and we startup for about 5 years. So I started the program, which is specifically for the startups in IBM, because it was completely new for IBM. You all know IBM, and you know that it's a big company. They have large customers, and let's say that the startups were not their market at the beginning. So they had to make a big shift. They did it when they started cloud and when they started the public cloud. It's a huge difference. Private cloud was something else. And they thought that now there is a new era, and the cloud was disrupting the environment, and the startup developers should get more power and more future. So how many are developers and entrepreneurs in this room? So if you can raise your hand, you are university. But entrepreneur and university? Good. Okay, oh, great, great. So half of you are entrepreneurs, developers. I will focus my presentation on few items because I have only 30 minutes and there is a timekeeper, so she will be very strict. When you Google and you ask Google what are the major reasons why startups like cloud, you will get a lot of stuff. For example, the top 10 reasons, or the top 5 reasons, or providers' reasons. And I found something because of the t-shirts, because of the nice t-shirt. So it was the bonus. So that's great. But you know, that's too many. According to my experience, well, I decided that we have to narrow this and to select only 3 topics. But before going to the 3 topics, I would like to show you something. So look at the timeline. This chart starts in 2011, and it goes to 2014. I will show you later on the rest. If I move and I go to 2015 onwards, look at the difference. So on this chart, what you can see is unicorns. A unicorn, it's a successful startup, like Uber, for example. Uber is considered as a unicorn. You can see that the number of unicorns increased drastically. And what is the difference between before 2014 and after? It's the cloud environment. The cloud environment was key. It was not the only success, critical success factor. There were more. Cloud was one. The environment, the ecosystem was another one. And by the ecosystem, we mean, for example, the funding, the VC, the venture capitalists, who are able, you know, to fund the startups in order to help them to move from the seed stage to the round A stage. So it means leveraging, instead of leveraging $300K, able to leverage several million of dollars. Another factor was the ecosystem with the incubators, the accelerators, and the universities. Accelerator, incubator, they will provide for the entrepreneurs the right environment, some co-working spaces, plus some mentors, some coaches. And the university have created some masters, specific masters for the entrepreneurs. So it's a whole ecosystem. But cloud was one of the key elements of this ecosystem. And cloud, thanks to cloud, the cost of entry was drastically lowered. And I will give you some examples on that. So that was one of the reasons related to cloud. Then innovation and competition, now coming from everywhere. With cloud, you don't need to stay in your country. You can go abroad very easily. You can sell abroad your solutions. That's easier. You don't need to move. You can stay where you are, and it works. And the third one was easier environment to scale up. Scale up, it's moving from seed, well, startup at the beginning, at the early stage, to a unicorn. So those 3 criteria, I selected cost of entry. The second one, agility. So that's the second one I selected. And the third one, scale up. So today, I will talk about those 3 criteria. Cost of entry. So let's start with the cost of entry. And I took an example, the example of MediaWen. MediaWen is a startup founded in 2014. and they are doing translation, subtitling for all the movies, well, all for movies, for televisions, for webcast and all that stuff. They started, it's a French startup, they started, well, in France at the beginning with the French market, and they had a limited capacity in terms of translation because it was limited by the number of people, by the workload, and by their, let's say, capacity in terms of resources, IT resources. So they, well, they work with IBM. They decided to join the Global Entrepreneur Program of IBM. That's a specific program for startups. And they used some API, which are on the IBM cloud. It's called Bluemix. And they use IBM Watson language translation, IBM Watson speech to text, IBM Watson text to speech, and all that run on Bluemix. So it's just to give you, you know, the scenario and the context. Well, if we have a technical person in this room to change, I have a video, a short video, but we have to go to YouTube. So we have to exit.
Boeing on SoftLayer and on IBM Marketplace, and it provides great tools. We save a lot of time. We have extremely competent people to work with, and it brings access for us of scalability. Our challenges are worldwide scalability and access to the market. So the conference is absolutely amazing. We are a first timer at Interconnect, IBM Interconnect. We hear a lot of great news. We have a close look to Watson announce the news of the APIs in text-to-speech, machine translation, voice recognition. So we imagine it will be a long-term partnership with IBM.
Okay, so back to the presentation. This interview was done during Interconnect. Interconnect is an event organized by IBM for his customers, but for his partners and the ecosystem. So we gave the opportunity to the CEO of MediaWen to talk to the audience in a plenary session to explain what he did with IBM. And now I would like to move to... That's no longer... It automatically, you know, it goes to the next one. I don't know if you want a Siri on MediaWen, that could be good. Ah, no, that's a cartoon. That's funny. Just, yeah, stop, if you stop, it's fine. Yeah, no, that's okay. It's okay. So, now, back to the presentation. Yeah, okay. Yeah, no, that's okay. He doesn't sing anymore, so it's better. Well, that was the context. He had the floor, more or less. He had the opportunity, you know, to explain what he does and to sell his solutions to the audience. And, I told you that I wanted to focus on the cost of entry. So it's for this concrete case. Of course, I will not share anything confidential with you, but it gives you an idea. So first column is cloud environment, and it's for 1 year, and the consumption. And the second column is self-managed, so it means that if you decide to do everything on-premises. The first part is related to the manpower, the workload, and you can see that the setup, it's setting up the environment, the servers, for example, the electricity, the data center. If you do it on cloud, it's zero because you will use infrastructure as a service. You will not do it by yourself. You don't need to rent some space. You don't need to install anything. And the equivalent, so we took the equivalent for this company. The equivalent would have been $4,000 for this company if they decided to do it by themselves in their premises. Application development is a ratio. So, you know, for 30 days of development on cloud, if you do it by yourself without using cloud, probably it will be 75 days. And for this one, we use some data coming from NAB. It's a research center, and they did some it's public, so you can see that. The difference comes from the 30 days. If you attend Clément's presentation tomorrow, the hands-on, or if you attended the one on IoT, you can see that there are, let's say, ready API, ready to use. So you can plug and play and use the existing API. You can also use the framework, which are already existing. for IoT, for example, there are 10 APIs which are already ready, telling you, okay, to optimize your work, more or less you should use all those APIs. So it's, let's say, already there. Doesn't mean that you won't have to do anything, no. But, you know, you will save sometimes. So that's the saving. In terms of management, management is all the security part and logon and whatever. So same, you will save sometimes because there are some, let's say, API, some logon system, which are already there. So that's for the workload and for the manpower. For the, let's say, licenses and the servers. So platform as a service and infrastructure as a service. For 1 year, they were paying for the API they are using $780 a year. So, of course, it's year one, only year one. But they were, that's what they are paying. The equivalent for a license would be $5,000. For the infrastructure, so the database, the operating system, the backup, the service level agreement, the hardware, the high availability, $500 per month. So it makes $6,000 per year versus $24,000 if they install everything on premises. So if you sum up, I didn't sum up the white lines because the white lines are, it's a ratio. But the yellow lines, you can see that year one, your spending on cloud will be $6,780, while, if the file is long enough, yes, while you would have paid $34,000 if you install everything on premises. So this is the cost of entry. The cost of entry will be much lower when you use cloud in many cases. Not all the cases, but in many cases. So let's move on. Let's move on to agility. Agility, what do I mean? 15 minutes, okay. Agility. Agility, well, I started with, let's say, the process of innovation. Startups usually start with an idea, Ignite. So an idea, then creation of a solution to design a solution. My solution could be that one. And at the end of this process, the outcome will be a minimum viable product. This part usually is covered by design thinking. And then you will realize, you will develop, you will scale. And you will use some extreme programming tools. I would like to focus on this part, IBM design thinking part. So IBM design thinking, I put another chart, and I know that there is a session, there is a deep dive on IBM design thinking. So I will be a bit fast on this part, but you can attend the other session on IBM on design thinking, and you will get more details. To give you an example, I have selected another startup called Advanced Solar. Advanced Solar, so solar, it means the sun. Advanced Solar is a startup who created a solar charging station. So you can charge, in terms of electricity, your car. So that was the existing business model. They sell charging station, solar charging station, to cities, for example, when the city has some electrical cars. You know, sometimes you can rent electrical cars in a city. Or to a company in charge of renting this type of car. Their issue was, okay, we have a business model. Our business model is solar charging stations and cars. What else can we do? So that was the issue. The issue was the hill. Okay? Then they say, okay, let's put it in another way. Who are the persona who could be interested in what we do? The end user. As a driver, you are the end user. You are interested in this facility or this service. And then there is the partner, the one to you sell to. You sell to the city or to another company in charge of managing the platform. So, sorry. You go through those steps. You start with an empathy map. Empathy map is you define your persona. So the final customer is a persona. So you put, well, it's which age, which profile, which characteristics. So you will design, you know, the person, and you will, to a certain extent, put consistency in this person. You can draw it, you can, you know, say long hair, short hair, whatever. But you will do the empathy map with the people you have selected. When I say the people, it's more, you know, the people you would like to sell to or you would like to include in your program, and they are key. Then you will define a Nazi scenario and an ideation. So more or less you are brainstorming, and you are brainstorming for those people. You are not brainstorming in general. Then you will select some ideas and make a storyboard. Does it work? You will do a prototype, so paper prototyping in our case, in the case of the IT people, it will be a mock-up, for example. And then you will define the minimum viable product. So, for this company, what does it mean? For this company, Advanced Solar, so this is the logo of the company, it means that after this design thinking session, the outcome was, well, we have a solar charging station for cars. What about bicycles? We could have bicycles recharged with solar power station. And those bicycles will be, you know, well, in France, there are hills, and so it's good to have, well, electrical bicycles. And those bicycles could be, let's say, rented by not only the city, but by some resorts or some hotels. So, you know, the outcome was new customers, new buyers. And that was the second, let's say, the second opening, the second wave. And then the third one, so I tell you the story, but it will be, it illustrates how to scale up. And the third one was they went farther. Then they say, okay, but we have a solar charging station. Look at this event, SECR. You all have your computer and your mobile phone. And probably you will run out of battery, well, this afternoon, for sure. For sure. So, what do you do? They could provide you, provide the organizer, with a specific station, solar station, and you can plug your computer, your phone, to recharge it. So, that was the third step of their design thinking session. The end user and the service provider were the persona they selected. And I illustrated only the part with the electric bicycles, but you know it was the same for the third stage. And in conclusion, the important stuff to remember when you have when you want to be agile, it's that it's an iterative process. It's not one time shot. Okay, yes, I have an idea, I make it, and it's done. No, I have an idea today. But, you know, in 1 week time, in 1 year time, you need to constantly improve your ideas. And it's why usually working with your ecosystem is very important. Because if you are a startup working in a co-working space, for example, or with an accelerator or in an incubator, you will get some mentors, some coaches. They will challenge you. That's also an opportunity, you know, to evolve and to have, you know, ideas which are new and growing ideas. And at the end, for Advanced Solar, the outcome was this one. So bicycles, well, they started with cars. Then they moved to bicycles. And now they moved to this type of stations, which are available during events, or this one, or in the streets. When there is an event in a city, specific event, you can put it in the street wherever you want. So that was the outcome of their, let's say, agility and the process they constantly implemented, starting with design thinking and then with programming. Let's move on to the third topic, scale up. So I put some definitions about scale up. Scale up, definition is when your startup becomes a scale up after it has validated its business model hypothesis, solve all the startup challenges, and thereby is ready for growth, exponential growth. What does it mean? It means that when you start, you will need an angel to fund your startup. And you will become a seed company. It corresponds to $300,000 more or less. You know, that's the standard. The angel will fund $50,000 and then the seed angels will fund $300,000. When you move to scale up, that's upstairs. When you move to scale ups, it means more than 1 million, more than 10 million, more than 30 million. So it will be a group of either one venture capitalist or several firms, VC firms, to work with you and to provide you with the right capital. This is scale up. So maybe here you have 10 customers. To go there, you need 1,000 customers. Here, you work only in one country or in one city, depends on the size. Here, you work internationally or globally in your country. So you have completely changed the paradigm and the environment. And there are consequences, huge consequences. If you look at your IT environment, the consequences will be, for example, on the computing power. You need more power. Maybe you started with one server. You don't need one server. You need 10 servers or 20 or 100. So if you are in a cloud environment, it means that you will be able to scale very quickly and to get as many servers as you need when necessary. Not all the time, only when necessary. More security. That's something very typical. All the startups I meet, usually they don't care about security at the seed level, at the beginning, because they are just interested in the application and the outcome of the application. But security, when you work, well, if you take the example of Sberbank, big bank, you all know it. If they are ready to buy your application, they will ask you, okay, I am a bank, you know, so the level of security I want is this one. Are you ready for that? Are you? So, on cloud, you are able to find some API related to security. That will be the good opportunity, you know, to improve the level of security and the standard of security of your application. More robustness. What does it mean? It means that instead of having, 100 transactions per second, you will get 10,000 or 1 million transactions per second. So, is your system, your application, able to cope with that and to increase with the peak, for example? That's another issue. More functionalities. More functionality, typically, you will be able to add some analytics component in your application or artificial intelligence. I have just selected those ones because they are the most important for the time being, so and the most successful. Or the chatbot or the IoT. That was exactly, you know, the case of the two examples I gave you. In the case of MediaWen, they had to do all the first three, plus they added some analytics and some artificial intelligence. And the artificial intelligence was there to, to do some more than automatic translation, a bit more than that, to teach, you know, it's deep learning, to teach the learning of the translation. That's what Google does, you know. But in the case of the other one, they had added IoT, Internet of Things, a lot of stuff on Internet of Things, analytics, and they wanted to predict the consumption of the environment, and they wanted to predict the charging of the station. And finally, for all of the startups, the geographical expansion will be something important. Data center, usually when you are on cloud, data centers are everywhere. In the case of the IBM cloud, we have 20 data centers around the world. So you can be in Russia and decide to grow in India and go to the data center in India or to the US and there is a data center or to Germany. Germany, there are very strict rules. So if you want to sell to the banks in Germany, you need to put the data in Germany. So you need a data center in Germany. Either you build your own, too expensive, forget it, or you use data center provided by your cloud provider. So you can see that when you want to scale up, you have to take into account all that stuff. And the cloud environment let's say, is one of the easiest and best environments for that. And I am on time. Final chart. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pascal. And have you any questions? But maybe for one question. Okay. No. All clear. Fine.
I will be around this afternoon and tomorrow, so if you have questions, you just try to find me and I will answer, I will discuss with you. Спасибо большое. Давайте еще раз.